It was said that when Buddha was enlightened, he did not want to teach. And his reason was that the people of the times, the attitude, the mood of the times was so sunk in darkness. Nobody could grasp the subtlety of what he had to teach. It was futile. So he wasn't going to teach, and some friends prevailed upon him to actually start teaching. And I thought that was quite amazing, because it certainly feels that in this time right now, what's the use? What's the use of even trying, actually? Well, I'll tell you what the use is. It's going to get a lot worse. That's the use. It's going to get a lot worse. It's going to get so bad. That we have got to try. That's how I look at it. Not trying isn't an option. So we have to try. We have to succeed. As many have seen, pointed out, this world, the attitude, the mood is in drastic decline in so many ways. What's happening is we're going into another cycle of waiting. Cycling is waiting. We're waiting for what will never happen to take place. We're waiting. And so we put all our creativity into motivating us to keep waiting, because we're scared to stop waiting out of a continuity fear. We don't realize we have this drastic continuity fear that keeps driving this engine of waiting. And so what we have to do is we have to keep projecting, like, let's say you're in a movie theater and you're waiting for something to happen, and suddenly a projection on the screen lights up and there's all this stuff happening. And you lose track of the fact that you're waiting, you're sitting in the theater waiting, you're bored, you're unfulfilled, you're unhappy, because you're waiting for something to happen. And nothing's happening. And you keep, but the movie distracts you from knowing that you're waiting for something to happen, and nothing ever happens. No outcomes ever take place, actually. There are no such thing as outcomes. Whereas the movie is full of all this action and outcomes and troubles and distress and disasters and everything. And so we believe, and we're sitting there watching the movie, that this is why I feel the way I feel. The movie's causing it. And if I just wait, the movie will get better. You see, we can manipulate the movie, right? And so by changing the movie and the following the plot of the movie, we say, okay, now this kingdom is under attack, but here comes an ally here, we're gonna be able to vanquish these people, and it's gonna get better. And here comes some, a scientist comes in with a bunch of new products and new energy stuff, and we're following this movie, and we think it's gonna get better. But we see, oh, this is the bad stuff. I see the bad stuff. But wait a minute, the good stuff is coming. So we're able to project this bad feeling of waiting for something to happen, waiting for an outcome, onto the script of the movie, and see the bad feeling there. And then we're also able to gain a sense of hope that, hey, if we keep waiting, it will succeed, because now we see that the good guy's coming in and vanquishing the bad guys in the movie, and we think, oh, it's going to get better, it's going to get better, it's going to get better. Here's what I'm looking for, the answer. Here's some transformative situation that's getting rid of the bad feeling. But it's all in a movie. Without the movie there, we would just realize that we're just waiting for something to happen, and it'll never happen. And the bad feeling is just this waiting, nothing more. So we have to keep projecting this movie of existence in order to keep waiting. So we don't realize that waiting is futile, and the bad feeling comes from waiting. There is no transformative situation, because it's like that. So this new cycle that's coming up is just an amplification of the movie. The screen gets bigger, the screen gets wider, it gets more intense. And we think that's our salvation. We say, wow, finally, finally the outcome I want. It will be there. I'm going to see the outcome I want. Occurrences, 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 so many occurrences. So if we do not set our waiting down, see, then we're going to get caught up in this cycle of intensified waiting, which is we're going to wait a lot longer for nothing to happen. Nothing can happen. We're waiting for spaciousness to be split. Spaciousness to be split. And we symbolize this in the movie of spaciousness being split, and then a good outcome of splitting and a bad outcome of splitting. And so the bad outcome we're trying to get rid of, and the good outcome we're trying to cheer on and say, yeah, this is it. So the bad outcome can account for how bad we feel. The good outcome holds our desire to succeed there. And we're deceiving ourselves because there is no splitting of pure spaciousness. So there's no outcome. There's no outcome. There is no good outcome. There is no bad outcome. Good and bad are this movie, this dualistic movie, that enables us to project and not be aware of the real situation that we're simply waiting with no hope. There is no good waiting, there is no bad waiting, there's only futile waiting. So as those who are getting an inkling of this and want to stop this waiting, set it down, it's not going to be a good situation to go into this new cycle of waiting, intensified waiting, a long wait. It could be a long wait full of hope, because all these idealistic, messianic ideologues, these PC people, which is really an entitlement culture, those who are able to say the right words and avoid the magic words and say the right thoughts, say the right concepts, avoid the magical bad concepts. They have this whole dualistic thing, they're working on it. They get this entitlement, that we're entitled to tell everyone else what to do. You get all of this at play, at work right now, intensely, intensely. It's really, so this whole good guy, bad guy thing, hero and villain, is so intense, and they act as though they're getting rid of the bad stuff. Okay, this is their goal. The goal is, don't worry, your waiting is not in vain. We are here to get rid of the bad stuff. We are the superheroes. Yeah, the whole superhero thing is so popular in culture, isn't it? The movies, the superhero movies, we're here to get rid of the bad stuff. And so we automatically identify, it's a superhero. They're here to get rid of the bad stuff. So my waiting will be transformed, or like my feeling will be transformed from bad to good. But waiting is never transformed from futility to success. Never. So what happens is, when the superheroes get rid of the villains, what always happens? The next sequel, right? The sequel where, oh my God, there's some new villains. Where'd they come from? Because we have to account for the bad feeling of waiting, right? So always, it's all about heroes and villains. And new villains always appear. In fact, we have to find them. We absolutely have to find them. As we see, we need to understand this here. That a situation of existence is, the good has to seem to be vanquishing the bad. The good has to find bad, has to, because we have to account for the bad feeling of waiting for reality to be split, which it will never happen. To see feeling of total ennui and boredom and unfulfillment and darkness and fear and confusion, just like nothing. I just feel horrible. We have to account for it through the villains, the bad guys. And then we have to have the good guys chasing the bad guys down. So there's no such thing in existence of just the good guys. Never exist. this is a fantasy that we have of a golden age. Everything's wonderful. Everything's fine. There are no villains. There are no troubles. Not true. What happens is, if you get rid of a whole bunch of the quote-unquote defined bad guys, whoever, however they want to define it, it could be anyone, because the need to do this is so intense that you might be a good guy in this script movie, and then people start saying, wait a minute, there's got to be some villains around here somewhere. Hey, where? And they could label you then say, hey, you know what? You look like a villain to me. And you get transformed from a good guy to a villain. You're now the villain, and now they're after you to get rid of you. And this just goes on perpetually. So you never feel secure. So if we have a culture that says, oh, the good guys, well, everything's fine. Well, it doesn't last at all. In fact, not even an instant. They would feel, we haven't quite won the big battle yet. See, it's always another battle. We always say, this is the final battle, the end all battles. Like World War I was the war to end all wars, and everybody was so sure this is it. This is going to bring all war to an end. Well, 20th century has been the most warlike century in history. And the 21st is also been intensely full of war. And yet the world thought, no, this is it. We're finished with it. So, after the big battle, we realize, oh, wait a minute, that wasn't quite the ultimate battle. So we're trying to find the ultimate victory, and we never find it in the movie. It just strings us along. We get strung along. That's all that's happening with existence. Existence is stringing us along. There is no other explanation other than that. It is simply stringing us along. Constant sequels. Searching for the ultimate victory, of which there isn't any, because it's simply a device, you see, to keep us waiting. And we have to be able to project the feeling of waiting. The script has to account for it, with the bad has to be there, and the good has to be working to get rid of the bad. Has to be there. It's good and bad, dualistic. The existence is dualistic, inherently dualistic. Inherently so, where we're looking for an outcome, but we never get the outcome that we want. We still feel terrible. Why? Because we're waiting for reality to be split, for pure oneness, for pure spaciousness to be split. So we get some and God gets some, so we can have our own kingdom, a separate kingdom. And we know that will never happen. So, but it's important to look at existence and see it the way that it is. Because we realize in history, looking back, say, wow, it's always been this way. It's always been conflicted. Always. And then, but we all think, don't we, that the future will not be so conflicted. We think, you know what? I think we kind of got it under control now. But as I say, even if every problem we could possibly imagine has been solved, the script of existence will automatically and inherently, without any way it can be other than this, label a villain, define a villain, so that a huge villain that it must vanquish and conquer and is causing all sorts of trouble, and you know, this always. There's no rest in existence. There's no peace in existence. There's no rest at all. No peace. Now, just seeing this may make a difference. The clearer we see this, it may make a huge difference. Because we're understanding, well, why is there no peace? Because it's the way to keep ourselves waiting. And we believe if we wait long enough, waiting has some magical power which will overcome the will of God. We feel that waiting is the way to overcome the will of God and force this split to take place. But waiting is this feeling like nothing's happening. There's no experience. I'm not really, it's like death. I'm not really experiencing anything. I'm just waiting for something to happen, but nothing's happened. I'm waiting for something to happen. And it's a terrible, terrible feeling of emptiness. And so again, we believe that this has the power to change the will of God and get us what we want, which is be separate prime creator. Therefore, we're desperate. How do we keep this waiting going? Because we feel like dropping it. And we project this play of existence then, which accounts for the bad feeling of waiting and gives us this hope that it will succeed by vanquishing the bad feeling. And yet, it's only a play of symbols, and yet we're still waiting and we still feel terrible. Thus, the play has to keep going and find other villains to keep vanquishing. So it's a constant, you know, vanquishing struggle, constant struggle, constant struggle. Just when we think that we've got it made, boom, something terrible comes along. You say, oh my gosh, why is the world this way? Why is existence this way? Always when I'm feeling top of the world, saying, okay, I finally got a handle on the world, I'll right away say, uh-oh, I know that here comes trouble. No question, here comes trouble. And then something absolutely comes along and plunges your life into hell again. So I got this hellacious problem now. In fact, there's many problems. Now what if we, well, let's not get too far ahead of ourselves. And again, we could look at something that we used to look upon favorably, but when we run out of villains, we have to have villains. So then we'll start looking unfavorably upon what we used to look upon favorably. It can easily happen that way. Or some new strain of, you know, plague comes upon the world, some disasters come upon. This is all coming from us. We're the ones who are desiring this, in fact, insisting on it. And so the mind has to continually, the consciousness continually projects this dance upon the screen, where we feel challenged by something that's out to destroy us. Now what if bodies were invulnerable? How could we be challenged by something that's out to destroy us? Something that's out to to destroy our hopes, like this bad feeling that we have in waiting. We feel that this is out to destroy our hopes and desires to be prime creator. It's trying to ruin us, destroy this. Well, it's destroying our hopes that we can succeed. So in this existence, we have to start out with that which can be destroyed. Okay, so the body, we have to have something which can be destroyed that symbolizes this vulnerability, this badness that we're feeling. So we have bodies which can be subject to death, this destruction. And then we view this death and destruction as bad, and preventing it as good. So we were always, with these vulnerable bodies, we're always able to find something that we're vulnerable to, right? Always. The air, the climate, the ecosystem. It's all, you know, famine is coming. It's just, we always feel like the body is vulnerable. So we have to have vulnerability in this dream. There's no vulnerability in reality whatsoever. Oneness is not vulnerable. To what? But again, let's not jump ahead. We have to have this something that's vulnerable to destruction, as symbolizing what we want to avoid. And then the good is that which prevents this destruction from taking place. Now, if there wasn't any body that was vulnerable to destruction, this whole play, this whole dance, couldn't happen at all. It couldn't happen at all. We have to have it this way. We have to feel that we are vulnerable to being destroyed, which is really this feeling, because we don't like the feeling. And we feel if we let waiting go, we won't get what we really want, which is to be prime creator. So we're terrified of letting this bad feeling go, right? So we look at it as the good is that which prevents us from letting that go, as it were. And we gotta have hope that we can keep going with this, even though the feeling we don't like it. We can somehow surmount this. So we project this feeling we don't like, this of futility, of failure, into vulnerability, vulnerable bodies. And then this idea of continuing to keep going in spite of this situation as what we call life. You know, I get up every morning and say, how can I keep going? That's certainly how I feel. I mean, I don't even know. A lot of times I feel, how can I possibly even get through the day? I just feel horrible. This is just, again, this is how it is we, in spite of feeling terrible, oh gosh, how can I, you know, do it? How can I keep going? I just feel like collapsing into death. I say, no, you know, there's got to be a way. We got to be able to keep going. This is existence. This is the play, which is just a way of projecting, displacing the feeling to somewhere where it was not really causing the feeling at all. It's a displacement. So we don't see where the feeling is really coming from, so we don't resolve it. We say, no, it's coming from this dream. This is where we're getting the feeling. But all of this dance of the play isn't really causing how we feel at all. It's our desire to be prime creator, it's our spiritual ambition, and it's our waiting, which we think will make it happen. But waiting basically says, well, sure, it hasn't happened yet, but it also hasn't not happened yet. See, it's like a suspension. It's saying again. You say, I agree, it hasn't happened yet, but it hasn't not happened yet either. It hasn't not happened yet. We're in sort of a transitional zone here, where we're not sure what is happening. But I don't really know what is happening. See, that's what waiting is. This feeling like, well, I don't know if it's happened, but I don't know that it hasn't happened. There's kind of like an unawareness. It's an unawareness. Waiting can be termed as this unawareness, a state of unawareness. And we believe if we just stay in this unawareness long enough, it will happen. Of course, how are we made aware that it happens? We feel that's the magic, that somehow there'll be something transformative, which will awaken us. That's the enlightenment we're believing. We'll awaken to the happening, that it happened. Yet we're afraid to be aware, because if we're aware, we'll realize that it hasn't happened. Definitively, we'll know for sure, be aware, that oneness is still perfectly oneness, pure spaciousness is still pure spaciousness, hasn't been split at all. So waiting is this unawareness. Where we say, I don't know that it has happened, it might have happened, but I certainly don't know that it has not happened either. I do not know that it's happened, but I also don't know that it has not happened. I can't definitively say one way or the other. I don't know, I guess I can't definitively say it. But this state of unawareness is we're really not aware at all. It's just a horrible feeling. I can't hardly breathe. It's a feeling like as if you're suffocating. You hardly breathe. You just feel so small and contracted and cut off and lost and isolated and separate, isolated, just alone, just feeling alone. This is waiting. This whole constellation of feelings of separate, separation, isolation. It's actually, we're just in a state of waiting, which is a state of sort of unawareness, where we can claim, I don't know if it's happened or not. It might have happened, and you know, it might not have happened. I don't know either way. So we can't never definitively say that it hasn't happened and can't happen, but we can't definitively say that it has happened or could happen. So it's up in the air, up in the air. This is all we can do. This is all we can do with this idea of being prime creator, of a separate creation, splitting reality, splitting off from reality. All we can do with it is this unawareness, where we're not sure if it can be done or can't be done. Has it been done, or are we not sure if it can't be done or if it can be done? There's just no way to judge it, no way to assess, because we're unaware. Just unaware. So it's really just a state of unawareness, which just feels horrible for us. Just horrible. Like a state of non-being, as it were. A limbo-like state. And we want to get out of this state. So, again, we feel if we just remain in this state long enough, it will happen somehow. Because we're unaware that it's not happening. We're not aware that it's not happening. We're not aware that it's happening. We're not aware that it's not happening. So we can always believe that, hey, maybe it's happening. I don't see any evidence that it's not. So maybe it's happening. And then project this whole scenario on externally, displace it into this dance of flesh, bodies, etc. Which seems to give us this hope that it can happen. I see it being symbolized. I see it being symbolized. Yeah, it is happening. It's happening. It's happening. Viewing all, you know, viewing nature, the dance of nature, and all of this. It seems to be happening. Something seems to be happening. The good is getting rid of the bad. What we want is getting rid of what we don't want. Except we're still in a state of unawareness, and we don't know whether it's happening or not. So we have to keep the whole thing going. The good and the bad, light and the dark, constantly fighting. The struggle continues. Continues. It's all, so that's all we're stuck with. We're stuck with this unawareness, and we're stuck with this vast struggle. And that's it. There isn't anything else. Except a return to awareness is all. A return to stop waiting for something to happen. So what we're doing is we're pointing out just how unappealing this whole situation actually is. And then I think once we get that, it's easy then to see, you know, what to do to set waiting aside. We've already looked at that many times, and I get it. I get it. I say, yeah, no problem, vision of oneness. But we still want to understand, like, what happened? You know, how did I start dreaming? Why have I been caught up in existence, right? We want answers, though. So what I'm doing is I'm sharing answers for all of this. Because in the past, what I see is those who, stories of those awakening, those who've awakened to the oneness. They say, it's just the grace of the guru. I have no idea why it happened. And it's just unbelievable, incredible. I can't, you know, just so wonderful how it happened to be. I don't know. How does that help us? You know, so it seems like luck. You know, like luck. Yeah, some guy went out in search of a guru, and the guru saw the guru, the first sight guru, dispelled all delusion, boom. And the rest of the life, the guy says, it's just total luck. I was just so fortunate. I have no idea why it happened to me, all this stuff. What does that do? What does that do? That promotes the business of the gurus, I guess, but how is that supposed to help us out? Well, maybe I'll get lucky, maybe I won't. What is that? We need more than that. So I don't... That bothers me in a certain way. We should be able to recognize why we're in this condition we're in, what's sustaining it, and why it doesn't work, why we keep feeling futile. We should be able just to see it, say, Oh, okay, I see it. Okay, well, this is why I'm now sitting down waiting. There's no mystery to it. There's no luck to it. we're just intelligent, just honest, intelligent, repentant, saying, I see exactly what I've done. I see exactly the situation. Spiritual pride, spiritual ambition. We want to be greater than God. We want to separate off from the oneness, have our own separate oneness that was separate from God's oneness, so we have to split. And since we can't do that, we went into a state of unawareness where we're not aware of reality. So we can't say that it can happen. We can't say that it can't happen. So we're in this limbo land. And then this feels so unappealing to us. We project it out into the existence with the body of vulnerability, and then that which is protecting the vulnerable, which symbolizes the bad feeling that we have of unawareness, and the hope it can be removed by ultimately be successful, unawareness successfully splitting reality. And that this existence then just keeps continuing on indefinitely, because this feeling of unawareness just remains just exactly as it is always. It doesn't get any better or worse. It just remains what it is. Unawareness. Doesn't know whether it can succeed or not succeed. Whether, you know, it doesn't know. It's unaware. It feels horrible. And that just continually gets displaced and projected onto existence. That's all there is to it. And then you realize you have a severe continuity problem because you have this unawareness, and you think, oh my gosh, I've been unaware for so long. What happens when I'm aware? I'm terrified of awareness now. To drop this, you know, waiting game of unawareness, we have a severe continuity problem. But at least we know why we have the continuity problem now. And we say, oh, okay, well, let's just work on it then. Let's get to work on this continuity issue here. There's nothing mystical about it at all whatsoever. But it's the unawareness that wants it to remain mystical and undefined and, you know, fuzzy, and I don't really know. I'm not sure. You know, it could be this, it could be that, it could be this, could be that. That's just continuation of our spiritual ambition. As our spiritual ambition dries up, get less and less interested in it, then it becomes possible to explain it more and more clearly. Very clearly. Jesus said to his apostles, look, you don't see very clearly at all what I'm talking about now, but if you listen to the Holy Spirit, eventually will explain to you and succeeding generations at some point, they'll be able to understand directly what I have to say. It's like that. We don't really need all these very highly symbolized indirect formats anymore. Some of us don't. And therefore, we don't need to mythologize it. The answers don't need to be put into all these, you know, various formats that the past put them into to account for the such a strong desire mood of not knowing, you know, not really be able to definitively know what's going on. Now we can say that we're aware of exactly the situation. We're aware of the situation. It's a different kind of knowing. It's not the knowing of outcomes, knowing of things and outcomes, which there are no outcomes, real outcomes at all in this dream. There's no outcome, right? In this dream, what could be an outcome? It's a projection of displacement to try and see the feeling somewhere else where it really isn't, and it just keeps going, trying to deceive ourselves. There's no outcome. Self-deception cannot have an outcome. Portraying what can never happen cannot be an outcome. So there's really no outcome at all here. So we can't know an outcome of existence. We can't say we know anything about existence, actually. But we can know. It's different knowing. We can know that we don't know. or it's unknowable. We can know it's unknowable. The outcome of existence is unknowable. There is no outcome. Setting it down is the outcome. That is the outcome of existence. We set it down. We don't need it anymore. That's the outcome. The outcome is we realize it was a dream, so we could displace upon it. So in looking at this, it feels like we're going indirectly, but we're not. We're actually, you know, a lot of effort is spent on yeah, let's drop the eye, you know. And the eye, actually, by the way, is the witnessing of outcomes, the witness of outcomes. When we talk about eye, it means that which is witnessing outcomes, which means really that which is paying attention to this movie of existence and believing that what we're seeing are outcomes. So it's the witness to outcomes, and yet we've seen there is no outcome to this movie. No ultimate outcome whatsoever. It's a continual dance of displacement. It's in the service of our desire to displace how we feel of waiting and unawareness, so we don't see the feeling, what's causing the feeling. We think the movie's causing it. Existence is causing it. But so the eye is simply believing and watching in outcomes. I see, you know, various things happening. I'm paying attention to outcomes, so to speak. That's what the eye is, the witness to outcomes. Now, there's also, what we do is we exchange the witness of outcomes for the witness of no outcome. The witness that knows it's just a dream, and there is no outcome to it, except that the dream eventually vanishes. Don't need it anymore. Because we're setting down our desire, spiritual ambition, which means we don't need to be unaware, which means we don't have this terrible feeling, which means we don't need to displace it, so we don't need the dream. So there's another witness. There's one that's witnessing this dream and paying attention to what it thinks believes are outcomes, to keep believing that an outcome is possible in the dream, which it isn't. And then there's another witness that's aware there aren't any outcomes taking place. The witness of no outcome. Witness of no outcome. This is the vision of oneness. There's still an I, but this is now a witness. I means a witness. So there's still an I. People ask, what happens when you drop the I? Well, there's still an I. The eye we drop is the witness to outcomes of the dream. And the new eye we have is the witness to no outcome of the dream. We simply set the whole dream down. We realize it's just that we don't need to see any outcome at all. But the setting it down is the outcome. Not needing it is the outcome. Nothing ever happened. As far as the dream goes, it is totally inconsequential. As far as reality goes, 100%. So if it's totally inconsequential, how can we say there's outcomes? So it's the witness to no outcome. It's still I. It's still a sense of witnessing. Witness awareness, okay? So we're used to witness awareness of this I looking, witnessing outcomes, hopeful outcomes that enable this displacement to keep, you know, taking place. Hopeful outcomes. Yeah, I'm witnessing hopeful outcomes here. And so that's witnessing. And then we exchange that witnessing for witnessing of no outcomes here. The outcome is setting it down. Setting it down is the only outcome. Still witnessing. We're witnessing to that the dream has no outcomes. There's no outcome of the dream whatsoever. So there's still a witnessing I. That solves the continuity problem. It's like zero times zero. There's still a number of multiplication. There's still a witness. There's still an eyewitness, as it is, in the right context, and that it, the dream's not doing anything. It's not producing any outcome. It's not producing any outcome whatsoever. But we can still talk about, well, there's a witness, an eye, which is an eye, okay? That which is interested in wit, in this is relevant, vital to it, right? And ultimately, the eye is the desire to be prime creator, spiritual ambition, gives rise to this feeling of interest, vital interest in all of this. And we don't have to worry about what's beyond the witness of the vision of oneness, the eye that is witnessing no outcomes. Because beyond that, we will intrinsically understand the situation so clearly that it's a piece of cake to the next step. We'll see it so clearly. But right now, we don't need to worry about that. But we're looking to see clearly how to exchange one eye for another, one witnessing state for another witnessing state. We're not trying to get rid of the witnessing state. Not trying to get rid of the eye witnessing state. Just trying to view the dream in a different light, different perspective. One views it as outcomes are happening. The other views it as there are no outcomes happening. When we truly repent, we don't need outcomes. We don't need to believe in outcomes anymore of the dream. Because again, it's always only a displacement device. And when we're willing to drop our unawareness, we don't need a displacement device. We don't need it. Imagine if we were like pinching ourselves, like causing ourselves severe pain. But we felt that this pinching and pain is going to bring us ultimate happiness. But we want to stop it. It's so painful, I want to stop it, but I need to keep doing it. So we imagine there's some two people on the screen. Suddenly we imagine there's two people, and one of them is pinching the other terribly. Pinch, pinch, pinch. And you're looking at them and say, oh my gosh, that's where it's happening. This one is pinching that one, causing them pain. Oh, how terrible, how terrible, how terrible. I want the pinching to stop. But then the pinching stops, and we say, wait a minute. And then you start being aware that you're pinching yourself. So you say, well, yeah, that stop means it shows me the pain of the pinching can stop. But whoa, wait a minute. There's someone else who's coming in now doing the pinching. Someone else came along. There's more pinching. Oh, wow. It just keeps going on and on like that. All the while, we're just pinching ourselves. And we want to displace that onto this action out there. Saying, you see, it's like that. They're just like that. Eventually, we realize, oh, I'm pinching myself. None of the pinching was actually out there. I was just imagining it out there. So, do I need some outcomes in this imagination in order to stop the pinching? Is the question. Does anything have to happen in the dream? No, right? The problem wasn't there. So why do I need any outcomes? You can set the whole thing down with, you have to pay attention to what dream figures were doing the pinching and which ones were coming to stop the pinching. And none of that's important. Totally irrelevant. It was always totally irrelevant. So how can we say it's an outcome? The outcome is we realize we're pinching ourselves, and we need to, stop pinching ourselves. Ah, ow, stop. Say, oh, wow, okay, that hurt. Don't need any more dream, do we, once we stop pinching ourselves? Don't need any more dream at all. Don't need to project it onto dream figures who act out this pinching for us, so we can believe that we're not pinching ourselves. It's something else that's doing the pinching, causing us suffering. Someone else is suffering the pain. These dream figures are suffering, not us. It's a clever self-deception, isn't it? But, yeah, we're not suffering. It's the figures in the dream that are suffering. We're not unaware. It's the figures in the dream that are unaware. So all this unawareness in the world, all this whole stuff in the world is nonsense. It's a dream. Nobody, none of these stick figures are either awake or asleep. They're simply stick figures acting out a dream. Dream figures. So, since they're dream figures, how can there be any meaningful outcome to any of the action that's taking place? It's not meaningful. So the witness, the eye that is watching this dream, thinking that it's relevant and meaningful, this delusion, self-delusion. Where there's another witness who can watch the action and see that it's just a dream and has no relevance. It sees that we're pinching ourselves. And so it says there's no relevance. No outcomes are taking place in the dream whatsoever. Just because someone in the dream stops pinching someone else in the dream doesn't mean that we've stopped pinching ourselves. Doesn't mean that at all. And what happens is, again, some other pincher comes along. And we say, okay, that's where the feeling's coming now. Okay, I thought it might be gone, but now I did. Okay, now I see. It's still there. And now I see the new villain entered. Okay, they're the ones. And there's an eye that can see that all this is just nonsense. It's a witness to the nonsense. It's a witness that everything is inherently in oneness, inherently in the one spacious, the one spaciousness, the unsplit spaciousness, the one spaciousness. Everything's always there. Cannot separate from it. Cannot be pinched. But we can choose to be unaware of this. The pinching of ourselves is the unawareness of it. It doesn't change the facts at all. So it's not too difficult to look at this. We may not be able to think, okay, I got it exactly right. It doesn't matter. We've got it. We've brought it to light enough, but we've just kind of, looking at it. It's like tourists. You're winding through a tourist attraction. You take some pictures here, take some pictures there, and you kind of get a basic feeling of it. But you know, if I went back the second time, I'd get a better picture of it, right? And went back a third time. You know, tourism is like that. They rush through it, and they kind of get a vague impression of it, and enough to get situated. And then they say, well, if I went back again, I'd feel a lot more familiar. So a lot of times people like to go back to the same spot a second time and really feel settled into it, and maybe even a third time, fourth time. And eventually you feel like, wow, I really can, now I'm really seeing clearly, what's here at this tourist site. So it's very similar to that, we can look at it, get this, oh, now I see it, but we're not really, we're not super clear about it. But at least we know it's there. We can say, yeah, I think I'd like to go back to that and look at it again. That's all we're doing. That's all we're doing. We're visiting this tourist site, like taking some pictures. So I'm like saying, yeah. I feel like, yeah, this is, I can see this. This is easy, not difficult. But still there's a feeling like, well, is it quite clear enough yet? I'm not sure. But that's the unawareness. We can't really tell. We don't really know if the oneness is there. Although we have certain experiences which will show us that it is there. It's not something that needs to be established. So there's nothing in the dream that needs to establish the oneness, you see. There's no outcomes necessary. All the outcomes in the dream are just symbolic anyway, they're meaningless. But certainly no outcomes are necessary other than just to drop our unawareness. That's it. That's all that has to happen, is simply to drop our unawareness. And then we'll be aware that nothing needs to happen. There doesn't need to be any outcome. It's already one. It doesn't need to be established. See, the reality doesn't need an outcome. It's already what it is. So we just have this unawareness of this fact. Is willful unawareness in service of spiritual ambition. So all we have to do is drop this unawareness, and we'll just say, "Oh, it's a hallucination of blindness, a willful blindness, hallucinating our own blindness on awareness. We drop that and we say, oh, it's all one. I see it's plain as day. It's obvious, completely self-evident. It doesn't have to be established. We have to say, well what was the cause of this? You know, what caused this outcome? This is an outcome of something. No, it's not an outcome. It's uncaused. I mean, it's not an outcome of something else. All right? It's not dualistic. It's not this, vanquish this, bring about this good outcome. We're still thinking in terms of the dream, the good and the bad, the good getting rid of the bad feeling. You know, there is none of that in reality. There's never any challenge to reality like that, really. So it's uncaused. It's uncaused. It's not an outcome of something else. It's always this way. And when this is uncaused, we call it uncaused, it's not an outcome. It's not an outcome. It wasn't established. It's always been. It's always been. Not established. It's always been. So we have this trouble between the dream and reality. We think reality needs to be like the dream. That's the continuity problem. So this continuity problem is the big problem that we're working on. Because we feel like, okay, I see the oneness, but what caused the oneness? How is it established? We're thinking in terms of the dream, right? Okay, what bad, evil force was vanquished so that we now have this oneness? There wasn't any equal bad, evil force that was vanquished. But then we say, huh? What is this then? Is it a dream? Yeah, and then we have this problem, which is the dream and which is reality? And just being aware of these difficulties is very, very helpful. Very, very helpful. So we won't panic, we won't get all flustered. We might be able just to look at it and smile. And say, ah, I see, that's a continuity fear right there. There I see one. So if we've admitted, we say have this terrible continuity fear, so when we see the various tentacles of it, we come prying these tentacles off. Oh, there's another tentacle, how great. Let me pry this off. Oh, there's another one, let me pry this on. Gradually we pry these tentacles off of our continuity fear. So at some point, unawareness can just slip away, and we're not freaked out by it at all. And it's great to find these tentacles that are attached to us, tentacles of fear, so that we can start working to pry them away. That's every day. It's like, let me find some more tentacles here. Let me dig deeper into the continuity fear and find out what's holding me back. We say, oh, now I see that we want the oneness to be an outcome. And we want to know what badness was destroyed, so we make sure that defend against it ever coming back again. And we realize, oh, wait a minute, that was the dream, which was a dream of displacement device. And I was pinching myself, I was causing my own unawareness. And since I let it go, I let it go, now I'm just seeing what was always here. I was unaware of what was always here. So the cause of what is here, my seeing is I just let go of my willful hallucination of blindness that was keeping me from seeing what was here. But that didn't cause it to be here, you see. It didn't cause it to be here. It was always here. And so we have to kind of iron out this confusion like that. Unawareness isn't causative. So we're not taking the mystical path here, really. We're actually consciously ironing out the continuity fear, prying the tentacles off one by one, which is fine. It's the safe, sure way. And there's a lot of spiritual romanticism in the past, so much. Like, so-and-so decided to leave home at the age of 12 and decided, I want to be enlightened, so they journeyed to the ends of the earth and met with all these monsters and robbers and difficulties and sicknesses. And finally, on the top of a mountain, they found the guru. And in one glance of the guru, all ignorance was removed forever. And they said, oh my, how lucky I was, how fortunate I am. There's all this kind of stuff. It doesn't explain anything, really. It doesn't explain anything. And you just think like, oh, there's something that happens in a movie. It happens to someone else. This is what we have to set aside. So this is not spiritually romantic what we're doing. We're actually you know, in the laboratory, so to speak. We're getting down to identifying the tentacles and say, okay, we're removing this tentacle today, and this tomorrow we're removing this one, and we know that we are making progress, or we're getting rid of these tentacles of fear and confusion, and evaporating the continuity fear. We're evaporating it. We're like tourists. We go back and back to the same tourist site. We know where the tourist site is. We go there, and we get more and more and more familiar with it. We say, okay, I see this feature, this feature, this feature, this feature. Dispelling all the mysticism and romanticism, dispelling the spell. We're dispelling the spell, consciously dispelling it. Not being hit by lightning, and I got hit by lightning, and I woke up, and I was enlightened. You know, I don't like that stuff. You know, I got to say, I don't like that stuff. It can happen, but it's very dramatic. It's very like dreamlike, right? And it still happens. You know, you hear so much of that, and I just say, nails. You know, just no. Let us just have the courage and the honesty just to look at the situation. Just look at it. Just look at it. See it. Own it. Repent. Repent. You got well because you repented, not because lightning struck you. And, you know, it's there are some weird ways that it can happen. You know, the guy gets attacked. One day gets attacked, stabs in the hospital, and dies many times on the operating table, is brought back to life, goes through long rehabilitation, and had all these near-death experience, afterlife experience while in this coma, long coma, and comes out of it later and they're enlightened, you know, they're enlightened. You know. But what does that tell us? That we're supposed to get stabbed and, you know, something? I mean, how can we relate to that, honestly? that was their way, you know, but that's a very unusual way to go about it. And because we're so used to the hero and villain stuff in this dream, we tend to be attracted to something that seems very like cinematic and dramatic and good and bad, like bad guys attacked him and the good came in and saved him and all this kind of stuff. It doesn't really unravel the mystery for us, does it? Someone's struck by lightning, they're dead for a while, they have this vision of the light, they come alive back, and now they're transformed. They're saying they're talking with Jesus and all this stuff. Yeah, well, you can wait your whole life. You're not going to get struck by lightning, right? This is ridiculous. So I just don't go there. I don't go there. This is hard work. It's honest work. Honest, hard, non-romantic, non-mystical work where you see clearly, you clarify the situation. You repent, you say, I repent of my spiritual ambition. I realize my spiritual ambition has brought about this severe continuity problem. I've been displacing my unawareness onto this dream, of symbolic dream. But now I'm so used to unawareness, I don't even know what reality's like, oneness is like. I've been unaware of it for so long. So how do I, you know, ease the fear, ease back into awareness of oneness, that it's always been that way. It's not been, I didn't cause it to be that way. No villain that I vanquished, so it'd be that way. How do we evaporate all this fear? Well, by continuously looking at it, being more and more conscious of it. Conscious clarification. It's something that everybody can do. This is my point. Not everybody is going to be walking down the street and attacked by a gang of thugs and stabbed to death and then be in a coma for a long time and then wake up and be enlightened, okay? Struck by lightning. What else? You know, was it? Who was it? You know, this Indian guru was walking down a street as a young person, and some old lady's there. She throws something at him and hits him in the forehead. Instant enlightenment, just like that. You know. So we're waiting for these very cinematic, movie-like things to happen, and they don't happen. I've been waiting my whole life. Nothing has happened like that. Nothing has happened like that. I grew up on that, on spiritual romanticism. I know all the stories. But not a single thing like that has happened to me in my entire life. Not even anything remotely close to that. My life has been utterly prosaic. And so I realized, hey, I could wait my whole life and none of that will happen. And that's the feeling I have. I'm just not gonna. So I better get to work. And let's do it the certain way. let's do it the certain way that everybody can do, the way that everybody can do. But we're so addicted to cinematic type of drama that we think that enlightenment, suddenly the eye of oneness opens up just because of that. The whole thing about the mysticism of the stories, there's always cinematic, isn't it? Because it grabs the people's interest. You know, people are so cinematically, because this whole thing is a cinema, the whole is a projection, all of existence is a cinematic projection. So people are so into the good and bad. They want to hear stories about this. Otherwise, they're not interested. So maybe some of these things happen in a dramatic way so people can relate to them. You know, that's possible. They say, okay, I better have a dramatic awakening, otherwise nobody's going to pay attention. So I set up a car crash, or something. And no, for me, I say, no. I don't want it that way. I'm going to do it the safe way. And non-dramatic, non-cinematic way. Good old-fashioned way. Some places are more cinematic than others. But always in traditions, there's a lot of cinematic. It's scripted like it was a movie, you know. Weird, is the more the culture is into movies, the more it seems like the only ones that enlighten seem to be those who do it in a cinematic way, as it were. But I have a distaste for that. It sort of perpetuates the whole cinematic theme of the whole thing, doesn't it? And it makes you feel that you can't really relate to it. Whereas someone just basic blue collar hard work every day, you can relate to that. Wow. If I really work at it long enough, you know, I'll get it. Anyone can do it. Just a matter of, Yogananda said, a saint is a sinner who never gave up. You just keep working at it. You just keep working at it. So that's what we're doing, and hopefully, certainly, it'll be successful. Hopefully, very successful. Don't need any cinematic moments here, folks. Don't look for them. Just get the work done. All right, very great. That's it.